Provo, Utah. This is the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast with your hosts, Joseph DeGaulier and Caleb Schweiss. This is Ultima Final Fantasy. Welcome to... why am I so quiet? Welcome to another episode of Ultima Final Fantasy, the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast. I am Joe.
I am Caleb, and today we're going to be doing Dirge.
No, we're not.
Oh, we're not.
We're not doing Dirge.
Oh, God.
Do we have to explain?
We probably ought to.
Okay. All right. It's just a super, extremely busy week for myself, and... there were two games I had to play for the podcast, one of which was Far Cry Primal and the other which was Dirge of Cerberus. And given that I had what I thought was about 5 hours left in Far Cry Primal, I decided to try to beat that first. Little did I know exactly how much work I had in store for me throughout the week. So I did not get to Dirge of Cerberus this week, and I didn't feel that bad about it since we had a review like a week ago, so...
We did.
It didn't feel that terrible to just, you know, give it one more week on Dirge of Cerberus, so... We should have it done by next week.
Yeah, you know, I also ran into some problems with Dirge as well. I mean, I'm on chapter 11 right now, I'm pretty close to the end, and for some reason the disc I'm using is just... It's starting to cut out, like I'm not getting cutscenes, I have to skip those because it's freezing and the... sound is like off and then starts making this like dun, dun, dun noise, and everything's just thrown off, so I'm gonna have to use your copy
to borrow,
or borrow Jake's or something, because I'm not able to play the game without losing the story, quote unquote. And I don't really want to do that, so.
There's a pretty good glitch though. If you go on the Twitch, you highlighted a video with like this machine gun thing going.
Yeah, on. Yeah. There's like a part where a dude jumps on a machine gun really quick and just rocks me. So that's pretty fun. But yeah, but just a little bit after that is when the game stopped working right. So it is going to be a little bit. But this works out perfectly because it is time for our State of the Podcast. So 50 episodes ago, we did our first State of the Podcast. And we both went back and listened to that last night. And we're not going to do it like that this time, because that one was more about... our podcasts, plural.
We got a getting fat section that kind of covers that nude clan.
Yeah, we can go over that there in a couple weeks. But for right now, I mean, yeah, I think we're just going to... We got these nice little top 10 underrated Final Fantasy moments that we're going to discuss. And
Schweiss.
Yeah.
This is our 100th episode.
Yeah, that's pretty sick, man. This is
100.
A long time. 100 consecutive, albeit sometimes split up into 2 weeks. Episode releases.
100 episode and 16 100th, games.
Yeah, 100th time we sat down here and recorded. It's gotten...
It's 100 official episodes.
Yeah,
we
true.
Have
We've
mini-sodes
got minisodes,
and stuff.
Yeah. And commentaries, but none of those really count. So before we get into that too far, let's do a few plugs here. You can find us at UFF Podcast. Tweet me there. I will respond.
You can tweet me at Joseph DeGaulier. You can also find us at youtube.com/Ultima Final Fantasy.
In there, you can see our Twitch videos streamed at twitch.tv/Ultima Final Fantasy. Join me for my playthroughs.
And you can also join us on facebook.com/Ultima Final Fantasy. And you can support us on Patreon. $1 a month gives you the episodes as soon as we're done mixing them. UltimaFinalFantasy.com is where you go for everything else.
True, and please check out our other shows. We've got a Godzilla one that Joe and Drew, one of his friends, do. We've got Super Sexy Swinging Fan Fiction, Jacob and I's show, and, of course, Nude Clan.
The Ultimate.
Yeah, The Ultimate and Nude.
Yes.
That one's pretty fun. So, yeah, check those out, and we hope to see you on the website. It's a lot of fun.
So, our next question is, where are we in blank? And we kind of covered that, so... Are you what mission are you on to Dirge?
I'm on mission 11. I am nice. Pretty close to the end of that. I'm not sure where I'm going to have to restart from, because the game auto saves, but it was like freezing in between cutscenes. So
you're not
sure
if it's the disc or the save?
It's the disc. I know it's the disc.
Okay, well then you should be okay.
I should, yeah, but I don't know. I'm not sure how far back I have to go though, and it's a really long chapter. Like they start really piling on the chapter length near the end. it's not quite the, you know, four chapters, the first sitting that it used to be. So,
oh, that's good to know. Yeah. I'm where I was.
Yeah, I would say the 12-hour mark on how long to beat is very accurate for Dirge.
Someone messaged me because I think I was bitching about how the game looked on my flat screen.
Yeah, I saw that thing on the forum.
And they said, order a composite cable. And so I wasn't playing Dirge this week, but I did order the composite cable. It was delayed, but I received it yesterday.
Did you try it?
I did not try it, Oh my God. I will give you my full review, don't worry, of that composite cable.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited to see what that will, like, how that's going to change the image. Because I know those composite cables, they used them for the 360, right? The Xbox 360?
I don't know.
I think they did. And that's like a 720p-ish range.
Oh, okay.
So I'm not sure what it does to the signal technically, but hopefully it makes it look better.
That's awesome. You know, I kind of want to get one of those. Is it a red, white, yellow, I assume?
It's like a blue, green. It's the higher definition.
Oh, okay.
Version.
I might be able to do that because what I want to do is stream, 13 and all these other PS3 games using my TV so I don't have this tiny little screen. And I was thinking of doing an HDMI stream card or something like that, but those are like $100 and I don't know if we want to drop that.
Okay.
But if I could do something like what you're doing with the composite cable and just pull it through and then I see it in the HD on my TV, I would much rather do that than stream it in HD. I know that it looks better on the stream, but I just want it to look good for me, because when I stopped streaming 13 to do post-game stuff, the game was beautiful. While I was streaming it, the game looked kind of like ass, so I don't know, we'll have to see if I can...
like a literal ass?
Yeah, like a nice...
Oh, a nice ass.
Well, it was kind of low def.
It was a nice ass, but it was a man's ass, so it's a problem.
It's like, yeah. There's a little carriage there that I don't really need. But, hopefully I'll be able to use that thing, and that'll assist me in seeing the beauty of the ass rather than the sack.
You're disgusting. How dare you not? You know, Final Fantasy is a family-oriented...
clearly, yes.
...the series, and you're taking it to the gutter.
Yeah.
You bastard. All those true, explicits in the iTunes store. We're the bad boys of Final Fantasy. You know, that 100 episodes we're the bad boys of the Final Fantasy podcast.
Well, yeah, it's either us or damn Chocobo, I guess, because they're the only other Final Fantasy one that does swear all the time. I mean, Limit Break does, too, but they're mostly 14, so whatever. I guess we would be, huh?
Yeah, we would be. Damn
but
straight.
It's not the other one. Those guys are pussies, but... so, yeah. Shit, do you want to get into this? I mean, we got some news to cover. Actually,
we do got some news to cover. Let's do that.
Yes. Oh God.
News, news, news.
All right. So first up in news.
And now we're talking first up after all the mobile stuff and the. The Dissidia Arcade.
No.
As interesting as that. Oh, you're gonna talk about that one?
I'm gonna briefly mention that Dissidia Final Fantasy Arcade has added Garland.
Oh.
There's also some Final Fantasy Record Keeper drama dealing with drop rates.
Oh my God. 11 all over again.
So if you give a shit.
Yeah, there's a great Record Keeper podcast out there.
I say,
not actually listening to it. I just...
You just know that it outranked us for some fucking reason?
I just assume, yeah, that it is a great show.
Well, we'll see it die.
We'll have it killed.
No, it's not that. It's that I don't believe that Record Keeper is going to be a long-running title.
Like, yeah, I don't know. Who knows? It is a very... I mean, if we're talking about good ways to do podcasts, the niche audience is a good one, right? So now it's not only just a JRPG with a fan base that's willing to listen to a show, it's... A JRPG, one game.
This is what you're saying about a specific way to start doing podcasts. We look at what's popular that won't last for very long, and we do a podcast on that thing.
Yeah, there's like the Battlefront one. You remember that? I saw that it was in like it was like number 40. I was like, what the fuck? How is there a Star Wars Battlefront show in the top 200? Not even that, in the top 50. It's a fucking online only game. It's something just like that.
Well, we aren't going to stoop to that level.
It will die.
We will not.
It will die.
We're a long-running show. We're like the Simpsons.
Yeah. Oh, we're going to suck at the end, though.
Oh, come on.
Like 7, 8 seasons in, everyone's going to be like, all right, this isn't funny anymore.
Another little piece of news for Japanese players of FF14. Apparently, 7-Eleven has a deal over there, a campaign event that I'm not sure if it's still going right now, but it's pretty cool. So apparently purchasing soft drinks will give you a code on your receipt, which can be redeemed on the campaign site for points.
Points.
And that can give you special in-game items such as the Aetherite ticket, Deluxe Heavens Cracker, MGP Gold Card, Crag Mask, and Housemaid Attire.
Crag Mask? Is that like from 11, the Crags, I assume? Oh, yeah, they're selling out of soda, apparently.
But, yeah, the people are buying soda en masse.
Wow, dude, this... It's so easy to market over there. You're like, yeah, let's just put the, you know, the JRPG codes on these shitty, like, outdated sodas that no one really drinks, and we'll just sell the hell out of them.
Just maybe a different level of obsession over there, right?
Maybe. I mean,
people would call us obsessed. I mean, most people. Maybe not some of our listeners, but...
Yeah, those guys would
be like,
call
you guys are obsessed with Final Fantasy. You have a Final Fantasy podcast that has done 100 weekly episodes in a row. We have not missed a week. We've had a couple episodes that have been like late a day,
yeah,
early on
especially.
But they were never missed, ever.
Well, we also humbly acknowledge the fact that many of our listeners have probably played the games more than us.
Yeah, that's true.
Then again,
but
many
have
of them,
they played all 14 in a row?
No, and there's not too many, I don't think.
Yeah.
That'll be the question from us to you this week.
Yeah.
So another awesome piece of news, guys. Final Fantasy IX is finally available for PC via Steam.
Yeah, they said they were going to do it. They didn't give us an release date, and then they just dropped it. Why did they just drop them on Steam?
I don't know, but it was it had an available link, because remember a little while ago, we were like, oh yeah, 9's on there, because it was on there. You could search it and click on the thing. You just couldn't buy it yet, but it is now out. There
launch
are achievements.
Price $16.79, and I think it's going to be $20.
Yeah, so...
So get on that shit. For all you guys that were all like, I know we got a lot of Final Fantasy IX lovers in our audience.
Oh, yeah. It's a good game.
Seriously. And I know there's some extra stuff. There's achievements.
7 game boosters, including high speed and no encounter modes. So if you just want to go through for the story, you can. An
autosave.
That's pretty awesome. And then high def movies and character models.
So they cleaned it up a bit.
Yeah, which is expected, but still awesome.
That's good.
Yeah, played 9. Pick it up for Steam. It's a much easier platform to play on than.
And we're
one.
Assuming we're going to get more FF15 stuff with the active time report that's going to be on April 21st.
Right.
And another FF15 thing. Apparently, this was said in an interview. Hajime Tabata and other FF15 developers have been playing a lot of Western RPGs, specifically looking at Witcher 3, apparently.
Oh, that's a good sign. We got a nice little image here of the dude from The Witcher put on. What is that? Whose body is that?
It's one of the guys. one of the four.
Yeah, I can't really tell. It's to do with the tattoos. Yeah, so that's cool. That game was supposed to be pretty good. I haven't played it yet, but...
So it's funny because with 13, it was kind of like the ultimate JRPG. Like they were going like super story mode, super linear, super streamlined.
Yeah.
And of course, it has these amazing graphics and stuff. With 15, I mean, they're still trying to do what works in Final Fantasy.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But they're also like exploring kind of the Western RPG, not aesthetics, but kind of, gameplay wise.
Yeah, and I felt that a lot when I played Disque. I mean, when I was out there roaming. When I was out there roaming, it felt like I was playing a Skyrim or an Oblivion, one of the Bethesda RPGs. It was just so very open. I mean, there's Final Fantasies with a lot of open areas, but this one was just ridiculous. This was just, it was just purely open, and that's something I'm really excited to see how they handle. I mean,
it's kind of interesting because remember when we went over the results for the demo, the original demo,
yeah,
stuff,
yeah, the difficulty and
they have to serve two audiences here. They got to serve the loyal JRPG audience and then the less loyal but bigger audience of the Western RPG players. So dealing with different different sects of Final Fantasy fans.
Yeah, and that's one thing they're really trying to push for with 15. I'm thinking
with 13, it was definitely geared more towards the Japanese players.
Yeah, it was. But with 15, I mean, we're already seeing the Platinum demo, right, where they said this is not really going to reflect the main game necessarily. Like, it's a completely different, totally isolated storyline. Mm-hmm. And it's just for fun. And it was to draw in a larger audience. So I think they are really working to appeal to the masses while still pleasing the core fanboys that have been there the whole time, kind of a thing. So we'll... I think so far it looks like they're doing a good job. But, I mean, we don't really know yet because it's not out. But soon... Very soon, yes.
All right, so this is a article that I guess, or at least the big points on the article. There was a Game Informer Yoshinori Kitase interview when he was talking about the FF7 remake, and there's a lot of shit in here. So these are kind of the big points, and this was posted on Gamatsu. It says it's going to be bigger than the FF13 series in... it'll be equivalent or even greater project in terms of scale, says Kitase.
Oh, wow.
So we're talking about those three massive FF13 games.
Yeah, 100-hour games of, each.
I'm not sure if he means development scale or the scale of the game itself. Either way, gigantic.
Right? Yeah.
Says it will be essentially a full-scale game with each part of a multi-part series. So it's not quite DLC. It sounds like it's going to be... multiple full games.
Okay.
That they're remaking FF7 into. How do you feel about that?
I don't mind that. I mean, as long as it's at least, if it's like a $30, $40 game, I don't think they're going to do full price for everyone if they do something like that. Obviously, they have the option to do that. But I don't know. They've been doing so many freebies for 15 that I don't think they're going to do that. Like the anime thing. That little anime series is free. There's all this stuff that they're just throwing out there so that you get it. You know, Platinum demo is free. So with these, I mean, if they're long enough, I think it's worth it being broken up. I don't mind that at all. And that allows us to get kind of a steady flow of Final Fantasy VII instead of just having one big ass game, which will be a pain in our asses. But of course, we won't play it for Ultima. Like we've said many times, we'll probably do it for Nude Clan because Cameron's never played a Final Fantasy, and we might as well make him play the FF7 remake because, you know, 7's a big fucking deal.
Then we don't want to be like, oh, now we do remakes.
Yeah, we don't want a slippery slope situation where we're like, oh, but you guys did this. So,
That's happened before.
It has. At the end of the day, I mean, we can do whatever we want, but we don't want to, screw anything over. But.
So he also says, with regards to the current HD capacity and volume, the idea is that we wouldn't be able to encompass it all in just one installment. So if we're looking at each of these parts, one part would be on par with the scale of one of the 13 games.
Okay, that's pretty fucking big then.
Yeah.
Because 13 took me like 109 hours.
What the fuck else are they going
to
add to FF7? Like,
I don't know. Missions? Hopefully they're not the Crisis Core missions.
Unless there's just extra stuff, which is kind of what I hope.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, if they do a full-scale rendition of Midgar...
And they know how many installments it's going to be, but they don't want to share it right now for some reason.
I'm going to guess at least 3 because they compared it to 13.
Yeah.
That's what I'd go with.
And in regards to compilation of FF7, if there are any areas where we can use the settings or the characters, we do want to try to incorporate it in there, but it gives off that sense of nuance and those other stories existing. But of course, it would be difficult to follow up on everything that's happened in this universe. So maybe some of the characters who weren't as famous won't appear or be mentioned. But in terms of the characters and instances that remained in the memories of our fans, we do want to try our best to integrate that in some fashion of the world. So that's what so we've been getting questions about, what are they going to do with Crisis Core and Dirge far as like what they're going to put in this FF7 remake universe. And that's about the answer you're going to get until we actually get there.
So we don't really know.
Yeah.
Like, it'll be difficult to do everything, but we're going to do some of it.
Yeah. So yeah, it's going to be action based, but not completely action based, I guess. He says it's going to be closest to Dissidia if he were to say something. He says the essence is drawn from the Dissidia-esque style. And then this is the quote on changes that I'm I'm scared of here. It says, I'm sure that there are areas that our fans want to see how we can change and areas that they don't want to change. The opinions of our fans are probably split on all of those elements. Yes, they are. So determining from a development standpoint where we'll be more true to the original versus where we change is something we hope to grasp through communication with our fans. Also, while we want to understand their concerns, we also want to get them excited for the story and see how it can be revamped and refreshed.
Yeah, that sounds like, you know, they're trying to fix some of the issues they had with translation, maybe change a few things, because if you think about it, there's a lot of people that are super stickler like you, right? The ones who are just like, oh, fuck this, I've already played 7, I don't need to play it again. Well, if they produce the same game, essentially, with a different battle system, that is exactly what you'll be doing. You'll be playing Final Fantasy VII again. If they change some things that aren't necessarily big changes, it might upset some people, but it'll at least give you a reason to look forward to playing the game. You know, when I watch, and I've used this example like 7 million times with the 7 thing, when I watch Game of Thrones, I know that it's a different thing. Now, there are still times, Barristan Selmy's death, that I get pissed at the show, and spoiler, I'm almost alert. Done. I'm almost like to the point of quitting watching, but I accept it as an alternate telling of the same end tale. You start off with the reactors, the Shinra, the Sephiroth. You end with all of that, you know, getting destroyed, yada, yada. Character development, meteor.
Okay.
If you start and end at the same spot, it's loosely.
You assume Aerith is going to die.
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah, sorry if you guys don't know. Aerith will die. And, you know, I that would give you a reason to play it. Like, when we play through it, that'll be something I'm looking forward to. Is like, oh, I wonder what they're going to maybe build on. Not necessarily change. I'm sure there's going to be some changes. It's just going to happen. But I'm excited to see what they will build on and, I don't know, make it a new experience for me, even returning to it as a remake.
See, this is what I would, in my mind, like the most as an FF7 remake, is just giving us the regular FF7 story. No different twists or different characters or anything like that.
Okay.
Just, you know, kind of round it out. Fix the translation, whatever. Make it understandable. That's all good. And then give us an extremely open world on top of that. So you don't add more linear story elements. You add more openness to the world.
What about like open story elements?
No.
Not something
not
like
open
with...
story elements, open world elements.
Well, I mean, I know, but if they're going to dive into that, they're probably going to touch on more storyline. I mean, like backstories for certain characters, stuff like that. I mean, almost like a Far Cry-esque thing where you've got your main scenario and then you've got these shoot-off characters that you can go do missions for, you know, stuff like that. I wouldn't mind that.
No, that wouldn't be too bad. As long as it didn't affect the core story that, millions of people love. And
yeah, I could see that. So are you still on the negative side of this?
Yeah, it sounds like a cash grab.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we know it's kind of cash grabby, but that doesn't necessarily mean
I feel like they could have just like done a remake that was like the exact same game with better polygons and like,
yeah, but
we would have all bought it on the PS Vita or whatever the fuck it would be on. And we would have all liked it.
Maybe. I only bought the PS4 one because of the Aerith theme and the trophies. That's really the only reason why I bought it. It looks better than the regular version, but I don't give a shit.
Well,
like if it wasn't for the rewards, the status, I mean, I could care less.
We're going to move on to our state of the podcast, wise.
I think we ought to.
Okay, let's get to it.
They say Seymour went to Macarena Temple.
Macarena Temple.
Hi.
I am not trying to do this.
When I dance, they call me Macarena. And the boys, they say que soy buena. They all want me, they can't have me. So they all come and dance beside me. Move with me, chant with me. And if you could, I'd take you home with me.
Hala tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena. Que tu cuerpo es para dar la alegría y cosa buena. Hala tu cuerpo, alegría, Macarena. Macarena.
So now we're going to do our top 10 100. I mean, we considered 100 since this is episode 100, but...
Yeah, I was considering that this morning, and I was like, no.
That's too much.
That's too much. We would have every moment.
Yeah, it would be nuts. Right. So we're doing the top 10 underrated Final Fantasy moments, and we're just going to kind of talk about why we think these are underrated in the zeitgeist, I guess. Things that people bring up when you talk Final Fantasy. You know, there's always Kefka, there's always Sephiroth, there's always... You know, Titus disappearing. There's all this shit that always comes up from people that don't even really need to know the series super in depth, but they're just things that people know.
And you know what? Going through the games like we have past these past 100 episodes, we have been witness to moments in Final Fantasy that do not get talked about in the general gaming culture. I mean, certainly a lot of these moments that we're going to list here are moments that deep Final Fantasy fans know.
Yeah, you guys will know.
You guys will probably know these moments in the Final Fantasy games. However, not everybody would understand them. Exactly what you're saying. Aerith's death, everybody knows it. They don't even have to play Final Fantasy. Everybody knows it.
Yeah.
Opera scene. Everybody knows it.
Fantastic, but yes, very well known.
Exactly. I would say the laughing scene is in the zeitgeist a little bit from FF10.
Yeah, that one's...
As well as Titus fading away, the screenshots of that, or the underwater makeout scene is what I call it in FF10. That's another big one.
I think I've called it that my whole life, actually. That's just like what it is.
The intro scene to Final Fantasy VIII, of course.
Yeah, that's a big one.
And then all like the Vivi kind of subplots in Final Fantasy IX, dealing with the falling mages and stuff like that. Big events, right? Cecil fighting himself as a paladin. Big events. These are things that everybody knows from the series, but... Those, like, if you were to do a top 10 of, like, the most amazing parts of the series, they'd probably include a lot of those scenes.
Yeah, that would be a pain in the ass list, let's be honest here.
But let's go with scenes that might have been, like, underrepresented in the zeitgeist.
All right.
Okay?
You kick it off with your 10.
All right. My number 10 is something that Final Fantasy XIV fans will know, but pretty much no one else knows
in
this series. With the... I believe the cutscene, it comes from the update, right? It comes from right before Heaven's Word. Am I correct?
Yeah, it's content right at the end.
So the two-hour cutscene before Heaven's Word begins in Final Fantasy XIV, there's a part where Rauban like goes berserk and fights a dude, and his arm gets cut off. And it's one of the most violent, visceral moments I've seen in any of the Final Fantasy games, and I feel like no one ever talks about it, maybe because it's kind of a spoilery type moment in 14.
Yeah,
but it is insane.
Yeah, that was pretty gory. Like, there wasn't a whole lot of blood or anything, but I was very surprised when I saw the guy's arm just get lopped off. I was like, holy shit. I was not expecting that at all. Like, maybe a little fight, some nicks, you know, some cuts, bruises here and there, but no, just fucking arm off.
Yeah. off. Exactly. you're bringing that face off visual thing for me there. That was one of the moments, because, you know, 14, I've generally, if you listen to the podcast, to the reviews of 14, generally I feel like the 14 story has a lot of good stuff in it, but it's generally told very slowly throughout. But when things pick up in that final cutscene, shit goes down, and it's awesome. And that is like, I mean, the princess gets poisoned as well, but like that's where Rauban's arm gets cut off. A character I don't even care for that much, to be honest.
Yeah.
But in that moment, I was like, geez, this game just whipped into awesome mode real quick.
That was a pretty good one. That was a very political subplot that was going on there that we knew about, but it didn't expect it to escalate to those fucking extremes.
No, not at all.
But there it was. So I've got one down here, the Mog brothers in Final Fantasy IX. Now, for me, when I was playing IX, and I know we rushed through 9, but one of the things I always think back about for Final Fantasy 9 is like when you did the tutorial sections, like
right.
these two, I've gone on, hardly went into. Yeah. I've gone on about these guys in our 9 review a little bit, but I just think it's so funny. Like there's this little Mog, right? And he's got his older brother Mog, and he's always going up to him and be like, "Hey bro, do you know how to do this?" And then it opens up the menu and like the, you know, you've got like the, how do I do this? How do I do that? How do I get abilities? What items do I need for that? Blah, blah, blah. The whole tutorial menu. And then at the end, the little Mog is always like, "Wow, you're really smart, bro." And then he like looks off into the distance and he's like, "Yeah, I know." And it just seems so epic. Like then it would just like the camera would just pull away really quickly. And there's this huge canyon with like a ton of fog and the Mog is just overlooking it all. Like a god. I just thought that was really funny. And like, I think
you're reading a lot into that.
Something that I just really enjoyed when I, you know, went over to there. And then you go find that area later with Quinquain. That's where he's from. So I thought that was a fun little moment in 9.
Yeah. So I got one from FF8, believe it or not. FF8's actually getting some love on my list.
Not on mine.
So there's there's a part in FF8 where I believe Alone or Ellen, however you want to say your fucking name, because it's spelled fucking weird if it's Ellen. There's a part where Alone, like, she takes you into the past and you start, you know, you go into the past where Rinoa may have been first, I guess, touched by the sorceress. And you're looking into the past as Squall. And then you see Ultimacia for the first time.
Yeah.
And there's this really creepy moment because the soundtrack is just doing the... It's just the chorus-y kind of thing. It's not any of the background
music.
The Latin
chorus.
So it's like really echoey and really creepy sounding. And then there's a part where you see Ultimacia. She turns around and she like notices that someone's in there with her in the memory.
Yeah.
And that part, like, it's chills, man. That part is such a great moment. And, you know, FF8... It's a mixed bag for me in many ways. I love it and I hate it at the same time. But that's one of those strengths of FF8 is that sorceress kind of like freaky, weird past magic stuff. It's awesome, especially when she notices you. And then it's like, oh, I remember the first time I played FF8. That was a moment where I was just like,
you're like uncomfortable almost because she sees you. And it's just
and like this is freaky. Like she's acknowledging you and the thing. I don't know. It's cool, man. It's cool.
All right. I've got one from Final Fantasy XII, the end sequence where, you know, they're going to ram the Dreadnought Leviathan to get it out of the way because it's about to collapse on Rabanaster. It's going to crush the city into fucking dust.
Right.
Any moment. And, you know, it's all of a sudden Balthier like comes over the radio and is like, "Oh, yeah, hey, we're going to get this fixed up, blah, blah, blah." And they're all freaking out, like, "Oh, come back to me," because you know Ash wants the Balthier, the leading man,
yeah,
basically to really lead and in the sack, right? So, and then we've got this cool little scene where him and Fran are trying to fix the airship so that they don't have to get rammed, because if they ram it, they're gonna die most likely. And there's just some really fun dialogue there where. Balthier's like, "You know, I'm the leading man, and the leading man never dies." And then, like, something crashes into it, and, like, some pipes fall on Fran. And he's like, "Fran, fix this." And he, like, turns around, and there's, like, shit laying on her, and she's unconscious. And he's just like, "Oh, God, I have to do everything over here." Like, he doesn't even care. He doesn't even care that she's knocked out.
Come on, you know he does care.
All right, deep down inside he cares, but he's just like, "Oh, God." And then he moves
her. Well, he's got shit to do.
He does, yeah. He got to get it done. He moves her, and then as he's picking her up and the ship's, like, breaking down behind him, she tells him that he's more of a supporting role, and then he's like, "Fran, please." And then it just, like, cuts out to the rest of the scene, and I just thought that was, like, so funny.
It's a good moment. 12. It's a good moment from FF12.
Like, the whole little interaction where he's like, "Oh, I'm the leading man," and then, like, in her moment of defeat, she, like, calls him a supporting role, and he's just, like, hurt. I thought that was a pretty fun moment.
That is a great piece of 12, definitely. Supporting cast-wise, 12 is... yeah, it has a lot of stuff there.
Yeah, unfortunately, the supporting cast should have been the main cast.
Bosh, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
My number 8 pick here, FF2, a much maligned game, a much hated game.
Yeah,
in the Final Fantasy series. However, it was funny when we started playing the games in a row. You kind of saw the origins of the newer Final Fantasy games in these older ones. They pull a lot from the old series, and they reuse or do homages to, I guess, to other older pieces of the series, right?
Yeah.
Aerith's death, though, not the first big death in the series.
Oh, no.
You know, when you talk to people, or you hear, like, you know, interesting moments in video games or whatever, oftentimes it's like, wow. And in the middle, like, this character that you've grown to love and know, halfway through the game just dies.
Yeah, first off, not halfway.
And there's literally moments in 2, 4, and 5 that are very similar in that case, in which a main character dies. The first one that I remember being very memorable, the first death in the series that I remember very well, is that of Joseph's, or Joseph's death, depending on the version.
Yeah, on the fucking version.
He's got his family at home, and he dies for the cause, and it's incredibly touching for a NES era Final Fantasy game.
Yeah, I mean, essentially the Indiana Jones ball found its way into a new temple, and it starts rolling down the staircase, and he like catches it, and he's like, "Guys, go, just go!" And then they're like, "Oh, we can't leave him here," and then it's just like, "Cough." It crushes the guy, yeah. And I was like, whoa.
And they reused a lot of that sort of, like, sacrifices thing for FF4.
Yeah, they do.
Yosef didn't come back.
Yeah, true.
And I think there were a couple other deaths in Final Fantasy II as well, but that one was the most memorable one. And, FF2 did it first.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
I mean, obviously Tella dies, but, you know.
Yeah.
That's a little different. He's like Obi-Wan Kenobi. Because he dies, and then he comes back in spirit form, like, all the fucking time. It doesn't even count as death. He's immortal. He was struck down, and he did become more powerful than they could possibly imagine. So yeah. That one was pretty good, though. I like that part in 2. And that's why you normally cite 2 as a better game than 1, just for the story.
Yeah, for the story. And that's it. Like, the gameplay is not better.
No. So my next one is stealing clothes in Final Fantasy VI. Now, this part I thought was really funny. So you're playing as Locke, the thief, and you just need to go steal some dude's clothes. Like, you get into a fight and you steal, and the guy's like covering himself up.
Yeah.
And then you just have to dress up as a soldier and go off and you fucking pretend to be him. I thought that was really fun. I really enjoy when the series kind of takes these moves, spells or whatever, or abilities that we've had, and just kind of throws them into the real world. Like, oh, well, yeah, you can steal, but now you're, you know, stealing the clothes off of someone's back to then go into hiding and get into this base, or, various things like that. So I've got a couple more on my top 10 underrated moments list that kind of deal with that. But yeah, I just thought that part in 6 was really funny.
They repeat a similar thing in FF9, but I don't think visually it is as funny as it was in FF6.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah. All right. So my next one is Terra finding love through taking care of the orphans in FF6.
Oh, okay.
Because, like, that's kind of her character arc, is that she doesn't know who she is. She's not someone who feels. She wants to know what happened to her past. And she goes on this adventure with these people. And in the end, we're not sure if Terra's going to join back up with the group.
Yeah, she's kind of hesitant because she's like, well, but dude, these guys, you know?
Because she finds meaning with the orphans. And I think that's one of, you know, there's a million reasons why FF6 is, in my opinion, the greatest game in the series. And this is just one of them. It's an incredibly, it wouldn't have worked as well if this stuff wasn't in there, like if Terra didn't, you know, find the orphans and learn how to love through, you know, giving, which is what she does there. And it's just an incredible moment from FF6 that I think is, there's so many incredible moments in FF6 that I think it gets overlooked often, just that kind of plot line.
I could second that. So speaking of stealing clothes and using the in-game spells, I really enjoyed in FF3 when you had to do mini, and I think you turn into a frog for one of the parts too, to like speak with the other frogs or something like that. It was really weird, but I think it's really fun when they do this. They also did this in, I can't remember what chapter it was. I think it was the ninja chapter in After Years, where you turn into a frog, and then you go eavesdrop on the meeting, like a little secret meeting that you then take part of as that character in the meeting. So it was a really cool thing, but I don't know. I just think it's fun when they take a really light tone to these spells. Like, well, sure, you can use frog on the enemies and mini on the enemies, but you can also use it on you and walk into this tiny hole in the wall and go find some stuff.
Yeah, little creative things to do with the actual spells.
Yeah, to make the spells seem like they're serving not only us as players, but the universe itself. Like, people
actually use it. So not just a battle purpose, but a practical...
Yeah, like someone came up with it and is like, dude, I'm going to get into anything I want with this. I can go anywhere. And it's like this really black market item, you know, this mini spell, because you can just go spy on people, do whatever. So I thought that was pretty fun.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good pull. That's a good pull. Deep pull. my next one is Titus. After he comes out of, I think it's after he defeats Lady Unalesca and the sun is shining in Xanarkand, he comes out and Sin is just there. And there's a moment where they kind of meet each other.
Yeah.
They and Titus basically says, I'm coming for you. And that moment, I think it's the turning point before the third act, if you're going to look at it that way. That moment really solidifies, I think, Titus is going to go defeat Sin. And it's actually kind of a quiet moment, despite a giant monster being there. The monster is just kind of standing there, and he, you know, shrinks away.
Yeah.
But there's that moment where Titus inject through Sin, have a connection.
Yeah, they kind of accept the fact that they're going to have to fight, sort of a thing, and then they just, all right, well, come and get me, kind of a thing.
Yeah, and I remember that moment quite well from my first playthrough, and people don't really talk about it that much.
I don't think anybody's ever really mentioned it.
I think it's a great moment in FF10, you know. Just another one of those things that just makes it great.
Yeah, little things really go a long ways in these games. So my other one is the princess in Final Fantasy II.
Princess in quotes.
Yeah, princess in quotes. It was a decoy. But anyway, you come back and they're like, oh, the princess wants to see you. And then you go up to the room and she's like in her bed and she's like, Firion, ... come to me. And she like turns sideways and Firion just like stops for a second and just walks in. He's like, all right,
okay, let's do this.
He pulls his pants off. He's got him like around his ankles, just like slowly shimmying across the floor. And then she finally reveals that she's a monster. So now you got to fight this creature with a raging boner, right? Because you thought you were just about to plow the princess of the kingdom that you're so loyally defending. And I don't know. And then you just have blue balls the rest of the game. I think.
Is
the plot for two. And I thought that part was really funny though. And
playing it for the first time, you're just like, what's going on?
Oh man, sex scene. But it didn't happen. But it was still satisfying. So.
No one tells you about FF2 before you go play it.
No.
That's what this podcast is for.
Same with five.
Telling you about games that people don't play.
Same with five. Everyone's like, either it sucks or I have no idea what five is.
There you go.
There is no five.
Dude. Yeah. Man, that's a good scene from two. I got a scene here that may or may not count for many people. I think they see it as part of Sephiroth destroying the town and, you know, taking Genova from her place, basically just pulling the thing out. It's a really cool cutscene. But I actually think that none of the flashback stuff would have really worked without the build up to it. And the build up to it is Sephiroth pacing around in the basement. And I just think like that little detail in the kind of the music that's playing while that's going on, and him like finding out about all the experiments that made him and everything like that, and what Genova is and everything, that is just what makes it's what builds to him, you know, going berserk on everybody.
Right. Yeah.
It's an incredible, like, I would say it's an incredible montage in the middle of the thing. God, it's such a good, such a good section of FF7.
Yeah, that's a good montage. Sure.
Montage, yes.
Yeah. So one of mine is one that's not talked about, mostly because no one's played it. So the revelation of the Hooded Man in Final Fantasy IV, the After Years. This was really well done. I did not know who it was, okay? I thought it was another character who we were seeing a weird version of because he was, you know, getting kind of fucked up from something. But I thought it was him and he was a decoy, when really it was a different character in a different form, like an evolved version. We're talking Charmander to Charmeleon kind of a thing here. And I was surprised. I did not expect it to be who it was, and I don't want to spoil it any more than the review episode does.
So it's the reveal of
the
Hooded Man.
Yeah, when that was, I thought it was really awesome, and it was just a high point for the After Years, and
it was good.
I had a lot of fun with that moment. So,
all right. So my next one is actually kind of a huge scene, but it comes from a game that's not played that
this
much.
This one pisses me off because I was going to do it.
Galoof sacrificed FF5. One of the more powerful sacrifices in the entire series. It's a series full of sacrifices as I'm looking at this list. I got a couple. it's just an incredible, like, you feel the power of kind of like the power struggle between all the characters in that moment when they're like hitting each other with when he's getting hit with the whatever, like the beams of magic or whatever he's getting hit with.
Yeah, when he's...
And just like, you know, the pain of like Creel and just it's such a great scene.
Just watching him die right in front of you. Yeah.
It's such a great scene. Like we talk about the Cloud and Zack scene in the FF7. That's a great scene as well. Up until the music starts playing. of course, yeah. But honestly, like Galoof's death is like one of the moments that, I actually think that like seals 5 for me almost, like
it is 5
kind of started out as a meandering kind of like let's go save the crystals kind of thing, and then it became something in that moment. It became something way more powerful, even in its storytelling, despite it being, you know, usually in general a weaker story than most of the other things. Like that moment really stands out in Final Fantasy 5.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
So my next one here is when Sephiroth, it's very similar to the one you mentioned earlier where he's soul searching, but it's when he finally just decides what he's going to do, when he figures out, okay, this is my only hope. And you go down there to go see what he's doing, and you're trying to talk to him and he's just ignoring you. And then he like turns around and he says, "I'm going to see my mother," or something like that. And then the track kicks in, and I cannot fucking remember what the name of the track is, but it's the little... Yeah, that track is like... That moment is so powerful to me. Like,
yeah, if only there weren't like 100 tracks in the game.
I know, I could find it if there weren't.
What's it called?
Yeah, I thought that was really, really awesome. And every time I play through Final Fantasy VII, that moment always stands out for me when he finally just like accepts his fate and goes forth to deal... You know, be the dealer of death for this entire village. It just destroys Nibelheim, goes into the reactor.
So it's after my moment, but before he does the thing.
Yeah.
So, right, so that very strong section of FF7, but like, yeah, those little things bleeding up to the big things. Definitely. Yeah, huge stuff. That's such a great section of the game. It's hard not to mention those FF7 moments. I got another FF8 one, Schweiss.
Of course.
FF8's going to get a little bit more love. FF8, I think, is more known for its like opening cutscenes and for, I guess, its love story than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
I think like a big scene is probably when Squall catches Rinoa and they're in the ship after they've defeated the proto, whatever the fuck they're called, and they go up to the cabin. Yeah, and of course Eyes on Me starts playing and then the scene is ruined. You know, that's probably a bigger scene talked about than this. At the end of Disc 3 and at the beginning of Disc 4, I'm not sure if it's the beginning or the end of whichever disc, the Sorceress Through Time montage/fight when they're going through the time compression.
Yeah.
That scene visually, PS1 game, amazing. When they're like flying through the air and graphically things are getting all fucked up and it's all really confusing, and eventually they start like each age of the sorceress Like, they have to fight through all of them, or like representations of all of them. And it's just an amazing section of the game. It's amazing.
And, yeah, that was a lot of fun. There were a lot of little mini bosses in that part, and it was really good.
Yeah. I'm glad you agree that there's something really good about FF8.
Yeah, I've never said that there's nothing good about FF8.
No.
So, all right, well, I've got another one here that's another After Years one, but it kind of ties in with Final Fantasy IV, and it's Edge fighting Rubicante in After Years. I mean, After Years is full of the same boss fights that you did in 4.
Right.
But I thought they handled it in a really cool way. Like, they were brought back to fight, and they almost wanted to lose. And in this one, you know, Rubicante realized that, you know, he killed your parents before, and he was almost like proud when you defeated him. And I thought that was really powerful. And I think that the way Edge handled himself fighting these guys again, because before he was in like insane turmoil because he, you know, these they're the reason why his parents are dead. He killed the, you know, Edge's parents, and just the awesomeness of coming full circle with that plot line in 4. Within the After Years, I thought was really solid, and he took it, man. He just went through and killed him.
Yeah. I feel like Edge fighting his parents in the first 4, all that stuff kind of surrounding that.
Yeah, that was, like, really powerful.
That was really powerful, but that one is one of those moments that they talk about. But, yeah, the bringing it back in FF4 After Years, yeah.
And he almost, like, wants to die a little more. Like, in 4, he's, like, weirdly friendly. You know, they're like, he's like, here, I'll heal you before. But, yeah, I just wanted to be a fair fight. It's really odd, but I thought that was really, really well done in After Years. And since no one ever talks about it, it's an easy one to pull from, so... I'll sit with that one.
So my number 2 pick, there's a part in FF10 where they're talking about going to the Makalena Temple.
Yes.
And I feel like I've never seen this mentioned any fucking place on the internet in my life. Not saying that it's never mentioned, but I've never seen it mentioned. There's this Titus goes Makalena Temple, and then Wonka gives a response, and then Titus goes, "I." Oh, it's a good moment.
Yeah, a weird, like, earth-shattering pop culture reference. Yes. Moment for you within the game.
The random pop culture reference. I fucking missed the first time I played the game. That would have been something I remembered. But this time around, I was like, oh my god. I can't believe that, like, who decided to put that in the game?
I don't know. It was totally weird, though.
Yeah. In case anyone's confused about that reference, look up the song.
That was pretty solid.
God.
You know, I've got another one here from Final Fantasy X. It's the... the whole idea that the Xanarkand Abes were a really soft and crappy team, because Waka's like, oh, yeah, a team living in, you know, luxury like that must have been pretty soft. And it's kind of cool because if you remember in Xanarkand, Titus is like a god, right? He is right. The player. He is the playboy. He's got all the girls because he is the best blitzball player, at least as far as we can tell. He's like the shit. You know, he's the Michael Jordan of blitzball. And he comes to this island, and you play the first tournament. Admittedly, Titus is better than, you know, almost everybody on your team, because they're all shitlords at this sport. Like, they've never played it a day in their fucking lives, as far as I can tell.
Right.
But you're not the best player in the game, at least when you start out. You can obviously grind your way to the top, but the guys who you play against...
So these savages from 100 years or 1,000 years before... Or-
well, it's later, but yeah, these, like, they restarted civilization, and these guys are better.
Yeah.
And so I thought that was kind of a cool little almost addition to the plot that, you know, Yu Yevon tries to push, where, you know, you need to work hard and you can't just have machines doing all your work, because then sin comes, and it's really, you know, that's a little, totally different thing. But it's the idea that because they're a harder people, they work, and instead of having other machines work for them, that also comes into play when they go to blitzball, because they're already strong and already, you know, in good shape from doing all the normal day stuff. They don't have to train quite the same way and thus are just overall better players at the sport. And I thought that was kind of a cool little idea that 10 constantly throws at you, but that one's a little less referenced, I think. I don't think anybody really talks about how that kind of goes into the theme, even though they obviously...
I certainly never thought about it until you brought it up.
And I know the machines are, you know, the whole Yevon thing is like a big lie, but still, though, it was a cool little commentary on hard work, the Japanese work ethic.
There you go.
It's a... Yeah.
There you go. So, my last one here, it is a huge moment, and it is talked about, so I'm not necessarily sure if this should belong on the list.
DNQ.
However, with a game filled with phantom trains, Kefka destroying the world, Shadow, whether or not you let him live or let him die, Celis's suicide attempt is sometimes overlooked, I would say. It's an extremely, like, that's the kind of thing that makes Kefka's destroying the world hit home more. Is Celis alone, and she eventually just decides to give up and washes up on the beach and survives. But that scene is very powerful from FF6.
Yeah, that was a good one. That was a lot of motion in that one. So yeah. good grab. But my last one, and probably this is one of my favorite, at least underrated moments in Final Fantasy, is the part where you play as Cid in oglop form trying to help everybody escape in Final Fantasy IX. And this part of this game is just so fucking random. Like, you're just playing the game, right? And then everybody gets captured, and then you play as Cid and you need to escape, and there's this key that you need to go grab. And in front of the key is a cage with a bomb in it, and there's this just this random as fuck little sneaking game where you press the control, like, X and circle to, like, slowly move towards it. When it turns around, you gotta stop pressing buttons or it'll see you. And they're just, like, in these ridiculous poses that are just completely impossible.
It's pretty fucking fun.
As this frog, and there's a timer in the top corner, so, like, you're kind of stressing out, like, oh, man, I gotta get this done, but it is just hilarious to me. And I don't know, I feel like I'm the only other person I've talked to about that part in Final Fantasy IX, so I think it is the most underrated.
God, it's amazing. It's like, the game just, like, throws everything else out of how the game works out of the water, right?
Yeah, like, this is nothing.
And, like, suddenly it's this, like, goofy... Yeah, this goofy sneak game, or
yeah, and the dude, like, turns around and, like, sporadically, so you can't even just time it. And if you mess up, you get a restart. So it's stressful, but it's hilarious at the same time.
In a game with mass genocide of clones and everything like that, that's a really standout moment.
It is, yeah.
On
it
the
is
humor
indeed.
Side of things. That's, no, it's really good.
Thoroughly enjoyed.
All right, guys. So those are each of our top 10. In our opinion, as we've done 100 episodes of Ultima Final Fantasy, started with FF1, working on Dirge of Cerberus right now. 100 episodes. 100 unmissed episodes. Those are our top 10 underrated moments from Final Fantasy. The overrated moments are perfectly rated, though. They're really great, too.
They are, yeah. There's no such thing as overrated in Final Fantasy.
Is there?
Maybe highly rated.
Yeah. I don't really care for the idea of overrated. I don't really know if that's really a thing. I think people are just douchebags who say that something's overrated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just hipsters. Is that you're saying?
Hipsters. Yeah, that's mostly it. Like, hating on something that everybody loved at one moment just cause it's too popular. Like, that really irks me.
All right. Fair enough. I can't counter that. I wouldn't want to, even if I could. So, yeah, shit. You want to get on to some questions here?
Let's do it. Oh, Okay, oh, so we have two questions this week. I think people were thinking it's a Dirge Cerberus week, as they might as well have, because we told them it was going to be.
Yep, we did. We certainly guaranteed it.
We do have one big question from Shinru. It's about making an FF game, and we're going to save it, Shinru. And also, thank you for the news.
Yes, thank you for that earlier. Greatly appreciate the news.
So I hope you forgive us for skipping your question for a little while. And if you ever feel like we've forgotten about it, just send us a message or something like that. It's like it's going to be like an episode centric question. But we got a question here from Stalus. So the rumor went around that it will be released on September 30th. He's talking about FF15. The question is, do you guys think they will include an FF7 remake demo?
Ooh.
Yeah, he says, I figure that Square might pull the same thing that they did for Type-0 to drive sales. Also, from the trailer we saw of FF7, the bombing mission looked fully playable? It also happens to be the part that was in the original game demo for the PS1 back in 1997. You want to... Well, let's see.
Well, let's answer it first.
What do you think?
I'm not sure if they'll do that, but I think that's a really good idea.
That's fucking smart, is what that is.
It is, but I'm not sure if that's really necessary, because there's so much hype behind the 7 remake already that I think it could stand without, it could stand on its own 2 feet without the 15 containing a Final Fantasy VII demo. However, I would really enjoy to have that. Just to have something else to play and to get a little, you know, experience on what the FF7 remake is going to bring us.
You know what? Final Fantasy 15 will sell millions of copies, at least 5 million copies, right? Should sell that much.
Easily, yeah. There's no problem with that.
I'm just thinking like 9 as the low point for a modern Final Fantasy, 5 million copies. I think that's like, that's the low bar for FF15.
Okay.
At least 5 million copies. So I don't really know if they really, yeah, like you were saying, I was thinking, yeah, they should do that and then they would pump up sales. But maybe for Square, it would be like not smart for them to put a demo with it so that they know kind of where their series is at with 15. It would be best for them as far as data is concerned.
Yeah.
And gathering data upon what media is working for them in sales. This is such a fucking stupid thing to talk about. But like legitimately, they wouldn't want to disrupt that on such a huge thing. They don't want to be like, well, was it boosted because of this? And how can we measure the percentage it was boosted? What it would be smart for them to do is to put the FF7 demo with World of Final Fantasy that's supposed to be coming out this year as well.
Okay.
Is that...
I think that would be a better plan, actually, yeah, if they pumped that out with another game.
Yeah, they got to pump it out with a small, like a game that's not going to be selling as much as a mainstream Final Fantasy.
Yeah, and that'll allow them to maximize their revenue, I would say.
Yeah.
Over putting it in 15, a game that everyone's going to get anyway, because then you don't get the people like you and I who bought Type-0 just to get the 15 demo. Like, honestly, well, I don't. And, that know, thing wouldn't be on my shelf if it weren't for that 15
and
demo.
And eventually, you know, we'll have to... Well, we bought the Uber version. We didn't even have to do that.
No, we didn't, but why not? It was only
exactly.
A little bit more.
So there's some Type-0 in there.
There is. There some.
Was some.
In those, the tarot cards and the manga.
Yeah, there you go.
But, yeah.
So Taka Mizuki says, I don't think they'll need to drive sales, in quotes. The thing will hype itself up and sell itself once they announce the thing's release, which they already did. Although I've never really thought about them releasing a demo of FF7 Remake, really thought it makes sense. They're really looking for feedback with their recent FF games, and I think they'd want to make FF7 Remake as much of a success as possible. Yeah. Isn't that with every project, though?
I would hope, yeah.
Now that you've implanted the idea, they might do it. It most definitely... Let's see. I most definitely think they will. Huh.
So he doesn't think they'll need to drive the sales, but he does think they'll go through with it.
Okay. Okay. Shinra says they don't need to drive the sales, and he doesn't really expect anything about the FF7 remake in 2016.
All right. Chica says she's with Shinru. Definitely 2017 for the 7 remake. 20th anniversary seems appropriate. We agree. She also thinks it's because if they release both the games in the same year, one will get more press, and it will kind of like overshadow the other.
That's true. That's what will happen.
Eyes on Me says she has a feeling that it'll be just that. It's just that, a rumor. Really doesn't think that 15 will be coming out this year.
Too late.
Yeah, Eyes already revealed. The FF7 remake demo, pairing it with 15 would make sense, and she hopes that Square will make this a reality. So,
there was a rumor or something that said that they needed to sell 10 million copies to recoup their investment for FF15.
Yeah, that's not true.
Yeah, that turned out not. Well, the company redacted the statement is what it happened. And they kind of said, oh, that's not what he really meant. It doesn't mean that we have to sell 10 million copies in order to recoup costs. It's that they're aiming for 10 million copies sold.
Yeah, recoup. That would be insane amounts of cost. I don't think they've spent that much money on it.
Should we calculate that?
No.
Do some Joe math on it?
I think we've had our fill of Joe math.
Oh, come on.
No need to taint our 100th episode with that.
And our next question isn't really a question, but it was put in the question segment area. This is about when we asked about the Crisis Core, why they couldn't make a remake, and if anybody had information out there that they could give us. Shinru says, the fact that Genesis is modeled after the Japanese singer Gackt, which we kind of talked about in Crisis Core.
Yeah.
Those music contracts are very hard to get worldwide digital distribution rights to, so Crisis Core is only available physically for the PSP. You cannot buy it digitally off the PSN, and many fans speculate that it won't ever be re-released in HD because of this.
Right, so he says a lot of tracks in the game that play near the end, like Why by Ayaka or The Price of Freedom by Ishimoto, which is awesome, have certain copyrights to Warner Music Japan. Whenever a game includes Japanese artists and their songs, and they are not affiliated or in-house musicians, so to speak, of the developers in Japan, the licensing becomes difficult. After the contract runs out and worldwide rights for music in Japan is insanely crazy, as I have watched some videos about copyright laws in Japan, and I found out that's why the stuff was getting muted in my Crisis Core streams, which I did mention before, wow. But it was because of the music. It wasn't really anything else. Like, that's the only game that I've had big time problems with, except for the few times when I was doing that Megadeth contest and like I wasn't hearing the stuff from the computer, but it was going through the stream. So like I'm sitting there playing a game, right? And then the Megadeth song is just going. When I looked back at the stream, I'm like, what the fuck? I don't remember
really?
That at all. Yeah, but it's because I had the mixer turned down on the volume end, but it was still pulling it into the feed. But yeah, that's why it was blocked. So I can totally see that being a problem.
Same reason why no Kingdom Hearts games have ever been released digitally. Because Utada Hikaru music in the game and her contract doesn't allow for digital distribution of her music in game from around the world or something. Just thought I
living
would
in the past.
So thank you, Shinru. That actually tells us a lot. So I say we just replace the music. Why don't we just fucking do that?
Well, the music was so awesome, though. That was like the part of that game that we praised.
No, that was his, like the pop songs in the game. It's not.
Oh, okay, yeah. But
there were tracks made by the in-house composer, and that's the music that we've mostly been praising.
Yeah, I've been blowing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. I get. And you know what? We probably don't even need those ones. You're right. They could just like omit it and re-release the game.
I can live without it.
Yeah, I'm sure you could.
You can.
I would be just fine as long as the heavy metal soundtrack stays intact. I would I'd buy it again.
Yeah. So we normally have a questions from us to you, but we don't. That is, in fact, that if you would like to leave us a review for Dirge of Cerberus and a question for Dirge of Cerberus, and you haven't already done that, there's a place to do that in the forums. So you can tweet us, or you can message us on Facebook, or you can email us at fffanatics123@gmail.com.
Right. So, submit your reviews and questions, and we'll answer them next time. We do have an iTunes review, though. Thank God for that, guys. You don't have to listen to that god-awful drumming and Ozzy Osbourne thing. So let's get into this iTunes review here. All right, so we have one here from Regina loves you. Oh, thank you, Regina.
She loves us 4 stars.
She loves us 4 stars. Ultimate, indeed, is the title of this one. Was looking for something to listen to in between Bonfireside Chat and Watch Out for Fireballs episodes, and this scratched that itch, very deep itch to scratch there. I tried listening to other Final Fantasy podcasts, and this one was the only one that didn't make me cringe.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yeah, that's a real honor. All the begging over leaving a review finally got me and decided it's the least I could do. Would recommend it to anyone who is looking for a similar structure to Bonfireside Chat and likes FF, obviously.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. I don't know what that bonfires.
Bonfireside
Chat. That is a pain in the ass name. I'm not sure what that is.
I looked it up, but I honestly can't remember now.
I know there's that fear aside.
It was a specific game.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Well, sweet. Thank you so much. Regina loves you.
Thank you.
We love you as well in a weird, not creepy way. So
yeah, thanks, Regina.
And please, guys, leave us a review.
Please leave us an iTunes review.
If you know what's good for you.
Yeah. And by the way, guys, stop. Or don't do that.
Why not?
That's not. No, we don't.
Just a taste.
We don't play that if we get an iTunes
just
review.
Just a taste. It's like a 2-minute painstaking process. And I only gave him like 10 seconds.
Okay. All right.
So as a reminder to what will come.
Yeah. So I just want to thank you guys for sticking with us 100 episodes. Especially if you have stuck with us since the beginning. I think there might be a handful of you guys out there. Can you remember? Our first day, we had 12 downloads.
Yeah, I do remember that.
Do you remember that? And it was me. I was texting people, begging them to go download our podcast.
Yeah, I'm sure today we have at least 15. So... But yeah, no, it's more than doubled. It is. It's more than doubled, probably tripled or quadrupled in size since episode 50 even.
It's at least doubled.
It's more than that.
Yeah.
It's been pretty awesome, guys. it's been pretty awesome. So thank you so much for sticking with us. And we hope to have another 100 to go easily.
Yeah. Well, let's see how many games we got.
Like 60?
Oh, we'll probably get to like episode 300.
You think so?
Yeah.
All right. I think we've...
All right, guys.
Either that or like 4 nines. Maybe.
Part of me is going like, Jesus Christ, when will I beat all these things? the other part of me is like, yes.
I love it.
Yes.
Yeah, so...
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, and we will see you guys again next week for our Dirge of Cerberus review. Until then, guys, enjoy the grind.
This has been another production of Ultima Final Fantasy, the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast. The show was produced by Joseph DeGaulier and Caleb Schweiss, with music and editing by Joseph DeGaulier, parodies and clips from their respective authors, of course. You can get all of our episodes as well as our Let's Plays at UltimaFinalFantasy.com. You can also contact us on Twitter at UFFPodcast, as well as our contact page on our website. Be sure to subscribe and review our podcast. Your reviews may get read on the show, and look forward to the next episode of Ultima Final Fantasy, the Ultimate Final Fantasy Podcast.